Facebook, who's on Facebook? Who can I say? Afia's on Facebook, and Theophilia, and I can't see everyone on Facebook at the moment, but if you're with us on Facebook, hello to you. Thank you for dropping in. If you just happen to be looking in on a Facebook message that someone else has shared and you don't know where you are, you're joining us at Trinity Baptist Church in Gorton in Manchester. My name's Wayne Clark, and I'm the pastor at Trinity. And today you're joining us on a special occasion because today is our church anniversary. In January every year, we celebrate our church anniversary. Today we're marking 45 years since the birth of Trinity Baptist Church. Although we have a longer and more complicated history than that, because it's 45 years since in 1976, Trinity Baptist Church was born out of three other Baptist churches, each with their own history. And we'll be reflecting on that just a little bit in a few minutes. But we want to look backwards a little bit, but we mainly want to be looking forwards. Being in church is a bit like driving a car. It's good to use your mirrors occasionally to look back and see what's happened in the behind you. But mainly when you're driving, you want to be looking ahead to see what's coming down the road towards you. And it's the same in church life. It's good to look backwards from time to time, but mostly we're looking forwards. And that's what we want to be doing in our church as well. So welcome. And today we want to have a very special welcome to our guest speaker today. One of the wonderful things about being on online the way we are at the moment is that we can welcome guest speakers from anywhere in the country and I suppose anywhere in the world. And today our guest speaker is Sam Gorton, who's a Bible teacher and preacher and radio broadcaster. And we'll be speaking to Sam a little bit later. And then after that, he'll be speaking to us from the scriptures. He'll be preaching and bringing our message from God's word today. So welcome to Sam and welcome to all of you who are joining us today at Trinity Baptist on our 45th anniversary. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you that we can be together with your people this morning. Although we're in different places, we thank you that we can be together. Some of us are with our families, some of us are on our own, but we are all together now as one in Christ because we come together to share our lives together, to share in heart and mind for the purpose of your kingdom, for the purpose of giving you all honor and glory, of giving all praise to our God who has sent us his son, Jesus Christ, and has given us of his Holy Spirit. We praise you, Lord, Father, Son, and Spirit, as we come together in the name of Jesus this morning. And we pray that we may know the fellowship of one another, the fellowship of the purpose in which we join together, the fellowship of God amongst us, and we may know you speaking into our hearts through your word. We pray, Lord, that we may know that oneness of coming together this morning, although we are in different places, we may be joined together in unity in our meeting now. And may all honor and praise and glory be yours in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
We're going to be singing some songs together. These song words and music will come up on your screen. We won't be able to hear each other singing, but please do sing along as well as you can. It doesn't matter what kind of joyful noise you're making this morning, but use this as an opportunity to praise God, not just with your mouth, but with your heart. Let's think about the words we're singing and give thanks and praise to our God. Our first song gives thanks to God who is faithful through the years. On this church anniversary, we're going to begin our praise by singing, "Great is thy faithfulness." Let's sing together.
God, my Father, there is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions, they fail not. As as thou hast been, thou forever will be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness, morning by morning new mercies I see, and all I have needed thy hands hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Sin and a peace that endureth, thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide, strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow, blessings all mine with 10,000 besides. Faithfulness, Lord, every morning new mercies I see, and all I have needed thy hands have provided. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. So faithful to me.
When the Lord was preparing his people to lead them into the promised land, in Deuteronomy chapter 7, he said this. He says, you are a people holy to the Lord your God. The Lord your God has chosen you out of all the people on the face of the earth to be his people, his treasured possession. The Lord did not just set his affection on you and choose you because you are more numerous than other peoples, for you are the fewest of all peoples. But it was because the Lord loved you and kept the oath he swore to your ancestors, that he brought you out with a mighty hand and redeemed you from the land of slavery, from the power of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. Know therefore that the Lord your God is God. He is the faithful God, keeping his covenant of love to 1,000 generations of those who love him and keep his commandments. The Lord promised to the people of Israel that he would be a faithful God, a covenant-keeping God. He said he would be their God and they would be his people. And that promise he also makes to us, his church, his people, that we are his people and he is our God. And he is a faithful God who will not let us down. He is the faithful one whose hand we hold and he holds on to us, because he is faithful. Let's pray. Father God, we want to say, as we have said through the years, great is thy faithfulness. And in this old great hymn of the church that we sing now, we proclaim that you are faithful and have been faithful through the years. Lord, in this 45 years of Trinity Baptist Church and many years before that of the churches that formed Trinity, you have been faithful, you have been good, and you are good all the time. We praise you, Lord, for your faithfulness, that you have promised to be with us, to be our God, and you have not let us down. Father, through the years we have known your goodness. Lord, we've been through some hard times. We can say that as a church. We can also say that as individuals and as families. We have known times of testing, but through those times, you have been good. We have known times of jubilation and joy, and through those times, we have known your goodness. You have been good. We have known great times of sadness and loss and bereavement and difficulty, but through all those times, you have been good. You are indeed a faithful God who is true to your covenant promises and whose promise has always proved faithful and true. And Lord Jesus has been the yes to all your promises. We praise you, Lord. We give you thanks. And in this day and age also, we thank you. We thank you for one another. We thank you for all who are part of our church, Trinity. We thank you who are all who are part of the Church of Jesus Christ in this country and worldwide. We thank you for the different countries that we come from as Trinity, for the different nationalities and languages and racial groups and tribal groups that we are part of as Trinity. And we thank you that together we are your gloriously international and intercultural and multicultural people of God. We praise you for that, Lord, and we rejoice in that. And we thank you, Lord, that you are the God of all peoples, of all nations, of all languages, of all backgrounds and cultures, of rich and poor, of male and female, of young and old. You bring us all together as one, and we give you praise that you are the God of all people and of all time, and that you are good. Faithful God, we give you praise in the name of Jesus Christ, who has saved us by your blood, who has given us life, who gives us strength for each day. And in these testing times, we thank you that your faithfulness remains and your strength remains true. Praise you, Lord, in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. For those who don't know anything about the history of our church, and we are a church that is constantly renewed with new people, and that's fantastic. Val and I have been with the church just 3 years now. But the history of Trinity Baptist Church, as you'll have heard a few times me say already, goes back to 1976. January the 1st, 1976, officially was the day Trinity Baptist Church came into being. What else was going on in January 1976? I wonder if you can remember what you were doing in January 1976. I know some of you are not born. Yeah, just rub it in, why don't you? Some of you were a long way off being born, I know, in January 1976. But for those of you who were born, and I was a spotty teenager in those days, well, what happened in January 1976? I looked up what else was going on that month. Jimmy Carter, who was to be president by the end of 76, was just starting his campaign to be US president. Emma Bunton of the Spice Girls was born that month. Yeah, that's how old she is. Niki Lauda won the Brazilian Grand Prix that month. The film One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest won all the Golden Globe Awards that month and went on to win Oscars later that year. Some things more serious were happening that month. The IRA exploded 12 bombs in London's West End that month, and their campaign carried on for a while after that. And to show that some things don't change, a motion went before the United Nations for Palestine seeking to be an independent nation. Yeah, 45 years ago. What were you doing then? I wonder if you can remember what was going on in your life in January 1976. Just a few, I think just three people who were part of this service today, live anyway, though maybe others who are, maybe some others on Facebook, maybe some others who will be watching the recording were around in the church at that time. I know Jeff and Doreen were, and Audrey was, Mike, Elaine, and then perhaps some others who haven't got the technology to join us today were with us as well. It was the month that three churches became one. Two were already joined together. That was the West Gorton Baptist Fellowship, who were Union Chapel and Birch Street Baptist, who had been serving the Lord in West Gorton since 1868 and 1878, respectively. And in 1976, they joined the church in Wellington Street in Gorton, which seems to have been called sometimes Wellington Street Baptist Church and sometimes simply Gorton Baptist Church. And that church had been founded in 1928 by a Mr. and Mrs. Brooks, who are the ultimate founders of the Baptist cause in Gorton and West Gorton in 1928. The history books tell us that it was Mrs. Brooks who was the main powerhouse of that couple. And they lived in a former farmhouse cottage in Wellington Street, but on the other side from where our church is now, in fact, on the site where the Plough-In pub now stands in 1828. And they lived there and moved into Gorton and decided that they wanted to start a Baptist meeting in their house. And they met there and started praying and having a preaching meeting in their building, in their home, which then moved into a bigger home and then led to a Sunday school meeting. And the Sunday school grew and grew until it needed a building. And they bought some land on the other side of Wellington Street, first of all, for a schoolroom and then a chapel, which opened in 1873. So Birch Street and Union Chapel and the Wellington Street Chapel all opened within the same 10 years of each other. All those old buildings are gone now. And we have our new building, although we can't meet in it at the moment. But we can do now what Mr. and Mrs. Brooks did back in 1828, which was to meet in our own homes, except we can be joined together by a technology that they could never have imagined. And we can worship God in our own homes, joined together by this amazing technology. And we thank God that he is faithful. He has kept us through the years. If you add up all the years of the history of our three constituent churches, I don't know if you can do that really mathematically, but if you add up the history of the three churches, you get 489 years of total service of God that have been given and the years the Lord has been with us. It's a bit cheating with the numbers, but 489 years of service that if you count back to the foundation of those three churches. God is good. He is faithful. Just a few of us have the memory of when Trinity formed. None of us have memory of when the churches began, but we can praise God that he is faithful and has been with us. We're going to praise God in our next song, which says our God is with us, not just for now, but forever. He is the God of yesterday, today, and forever. Let's sing this song, which says, give thanks to the Lord.
Thanks to the Lord.
With us forever. He's the one who never ever leaves us. He is our faithful God. On this church anniversary, we celebrate his goodness. We're going to be speaking to Sam Gorton in just a moment. First of all, just one or two bits of housekeeping. Welcome to Trinity Baptist Church in Gorton. If you're just joining us on Facebook Live, it's good to have you with us. You can watch this service at any time on our Facebook feed, Trinity Baptist Gorton on Facebook, or on our YouTube channel, which is Trinity Baptist Gorton YouTube.com/ Trinity Baptist Gorton. I knew I'd get that wrong. It's on YouTube.com, and then look up Trinity Baptist Gorton. You'll find us there anyway. We'd like you to join us again on Wednesday evenings. On Wednesday evenings, we have our Bible study and prayer meeting. We tend to alternate weeks between prayer times and Bible studies. That's at 8 o'clock every Wednesday on Zoom. And this Wednesday, we're going to be starting a new series of Bible studies. I think Jeff's going to be leading us. I think that's what we're going to be doing on Wednesday. But join us on Wednesday at 8 o'clock, and we'll be having a Bible study. And I believe Jeff's going to be starting a new series. But please do join us on Wednesday and each Wednesday on Zoom at 8 o'clock. If you haven't got our Zoom link because you're not with us on Zoom today, then do get in touch with me or Jeff or anyone in the church who can provide you with our Zoom link. Don't forget our Trinity phone message, which currently has an anniversary message on it. Pick up your phone and dial 0161 509 4409, and you can hear a message from the church each week. please share that number, particularly with those who don't have the technology to get online, because that's a lifeline for a lot of people at the moment. Now, next Sunday, I'm going to be speaking. I know I haven't been, I wasn't here last week, and I'm not speaking this week, but next week you've got me again. And I'm going to be introducing our text for 2021, which, if you get our church newsletter, you will already have had a sneak preview of what that text is. Next week, we're going to be launching it for real, and I'll be speaking on our text for this year and our theme for this year. And it's also going to be communion next Sunday, not communion today. I know it's normally the third Sunday of the month, but because it's our anniversary, we've put communion off till next week. So please prepare some bread, something that can be for you, wine to represent the blood of Christ. That's next Sunday. We're having communion and also our theme text verse for this year. So do come prepared for that. That's next Sunday. Okay, just before we meet Sam, let's have a open the microphones for anyone who's got any special, anything special to share, particularly birthdays, and we'll sing a happy birthday to anyone who's got a birthday. But if you've got anything else to share, perhaps an anniversary or a special occasion or a special event or special news to share, we'd love to hear that. So please unmute yourself let us know anything you want to tell us.
Doreen's
speak
birthday.
Now.
Doreen's birthday.
Who's that? Say again, Jeff.
Doreen's birthday on Friday. She's frowning at me.
Oh, Doreen, Jeff's let the cat out of the bag. Having another birthday.
And there's somebody lurking in the Bala family as well.
Oh, yeah. Whose birthday is it in the Bala family? Is it your birthday? Roman, is it your birthday?
Yes.
Mariola, you can hear it. Roman's birthday.
Next Sunday.
Next Sunday.
Oh.
Okay. Well, happy birthday for next Sunday.
Yeah.
Will you be celebrating it?
No. Nope.
In a wild way. Typical of Roman. No, I'm not going to celebrate. Okay. Well, happy birthday for next week. If you're with us next week, then we'll celebrate with you, Roman. But if not, we'll wish you a happy birthday now. Anyone else got a special occasion to celebrate a birthday or anything else?
I thought it was Saturday's birthday.
Anyone on Facebook? Val, can you see anyone on Facebook? You're watching it more closely than me. I can't hear you, Val, but it looks like you're shaking your head there. So, okay. No one on Facebook telling us they've got a special occasion or a birthday or anniversary or anything else. So I'm just having a look on Facebook myself. Hello, Abby. Abby's on Facebook. Can't see any other special birthdays. So, Doreen, you've got a happy birthday that we're going to sing to you. You're going to be delighted about that, I know. So happy birthday to Doreen, and we'll include Roman in this as well. Even though it's next, he might get it again next Sunday. So have a good birthday, Doreen. You probably don't want to speak about it, but you're going to be wild celebrations of your birthday. You're going to be celebrating with the family. Will the grandchildren be remembering it? No. Let's sing happy birthday to Doreen and Roman. So happy birthday to both of you. Let's sing together. If you want to unmute yourself so others can hear you. Otherwise, you'll just be hearing my voice. Let's sing together. Happy birthday
to you.
Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday to you.
That was a mess. Doreen enjoyed that. Father, we pray for your blessing on Doreen as she celebrates her birthday, and Roman next week, and others who have birthdays within our fellowship that we don't know about. We pray, Lord, your blessing on all these who have birthdays and any other special occasions coming up. We pray your blessing on them for this their special day and for this coming year. Lord, richly pour your blessings on these folk, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, we're going to move on now, and I want to make another welcome and introduction to our guest, Sam, Sam Gorton. Sam, if you can unmute yourself and we can hear you. There he is. Hi, Sam. Hi, it's good to have you with us today. Sam is a Bible teacher in many churches and on the radio and an author. Sam, really good to have you with us today. Where are you joining us from today?
I'm actually joining you from South Yorkshire, the Republic of South Yorkshire, a little town called Bawtry.
Yeah, about, near Doncaster.
Yeah, about 9 or 10 miles south of Doncaster. We're right on the southern edge of Yorkshire, where it's a blue sky and the sun is shining and it's bitterly cold.
Yeah.
And I'm so glad to be with you good folks.
No forecast for your side of the country, but you haven't got it at the moment. Well, it's really good to have you with us, Sam.
Great.
But we can tell from your accent that you haven't got the Yorkshire accent. You're not from Yorkshire originally, are you?
No, and I don't want the Yorkshire accent either. But I come originally from the Emerald Isle, from Bangor in County Down.
Yeah.
But I've lived in exile since the early-ish 80s.
Yeah.
So I've actually lived longer here on the mainland than I did back in home in Northern Ireland.
Yeah. Now, in normal times, when the pandemic isn't restricting our movement, tell us a bit about the work and ministry that you're involved with.
Well, for those of you who don't know me, actually, for the best part of 20 years, I was a Baptist pastor in Northern Ireland and in Scotland, and then was called into a ministry with Transwar Radio. So I spent 11 or 12 years with TWR as an on-air radio Bible teacher, doing a daily program, Truth for Today. And then I moved on from there to serve as director for a ministry among Jewish people called Messianic Testimony. And then just almost 5 years ago now, I set up Truth for Today, which is really our own ministry, which takes us around the country and literally around the world, simply talking, sharing about the Lord Jesus Christ.
Mm. Do you see yourself principally as a teacher or an evangelist or as a inspirer of people? How would you describe what's really at your heart?
I suppose I'm probably a Bible teacher more than anything else. That said, to every person who is called to preach the word, we have responsibility to share the gospel with all those around us as well. But probably more of a Bible teacher than an out-and-out evangelist as such. I'm not like Jeff. I'm a preacher, but I do the work of an evangelist, not like him, who is a full-blooded, card-carrying evangelist.
Yeah, that's right. Mm. And your Bible teaching and other work has led you into other media. As you say, you've done a lot on the radio and also written more than 20 books and study guides. And what's led you into different media other than just standing in front of people and preaching?
It's actually quite ironic, but when I came to know the Lord back in February 1968, 6 months after that, in my hometown of Bangor, they always had a huge annual missions conference. And it was at that conference that I dedicated my life to full-time ministry. And the keynote speaker on that occasion was the director of ministries for Back to the Bible Radio in the USA. Mm. And little did I think that many, many years later, I would be sitting behind a microphone, sharing God's word with many, many people around the world. My so-called friends tell me that I've got a beautiful face for radio, but there you are. And as for the written ministry, I started doing a number of articles back in the early 80s for a couple of Christian magazines, and a few people suggested why not put them into print. And that's exactly what we did. The publishers came looking for us. And 21 books later, God has been so good. And they've literally traveled all around the world, and they will be where I will never be. And that's the amazing thing about media ministry, be it radio or literature. They will outlive me. And I'm certainly grateful to God for that inestimable opportunity. And I certainly praise him for it. I noticed on your website that you're preaching on 1 Thessalonians next Sunday for your motto verse. Well, a little book I did last year was, two years ago, Five Marks of a Gospel Church, 1 Thessalonians Made Simple. And then I did one just come out just before Christmas there, entitled Great God of Heaven. It takes you right through the entire book of Daniel, which isn't just about a man in a den of lions. The focus of the book of Daniel is certainly the great God of heaven. So, yep, anybody wants to find those or find out more about me, go on to my website, truthfortoday.co.uk, and all the stuff is there.
Sam, thank you very much for being with us today. We look forward to hearing you speak to us from God's word in just a minute.
Thank you.
Sam's going to be speaking to us after we've sung our next song and heard a scripture reading, which Val's going to bring to us after our next song. Our song that we're going to have now is a song that speaks about the love of Jesus shown most fully on the cross, where he gave his life for us, which is What Kind of Love Is This? Let's sing this together.
What kind of love is this that gave itself for me? I am the guilty one, yet I go free. What kind of love is this?
Let's hear God's word about the love of Christ. And Val's going to read to us.
I'm reading from Ephesians 3, verse 14. For this reason, I kneel before the Father, from whom his whole family in heaven and on earth derives its name. I pray that out of the glorious riches he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power together with all the saints to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Amen.
Father, we pray you'll be with Sam as he speaks to us now from your word. Move his heart with the truth that you have for us, that truth for today that will inspire us and give us life. Amen.
Well, folks, let me say it is an absolute joy, as I said to Wayne a few minutes ago, to be with you again this morning. It's not my first ever visit to Gorton, I have to say, to Trinity Baptist. It's my first time to be with you, courtesy of today's technology, the wonders of Zoom. But my last visit with you was a way, way back in the last millennium. It was in 1999, when I was with you, I think, four or five times during that 90s decade. And so it's a very special privilege to catch up with you again and to share with you on this very special occasion. And so this morning, as Val read for us a few minutes ago, we find ourselves in Ephesians and chapter 3. And for what it's worth, I reckon this particular section, the second of Paul's two prayers, is one of the most sublime passages in the entire New Testament. For you and for me, it actually lifts us from where we are. It lifts us to a higher plane. And you know, I think it's so relevant for you as a church family, as today you celebrate your 45th anniversary. In wedding speak, it's the sapphire anniversary. Now, when we turn back to this particular chapter, I'm sure you'll agree with me when I say this morning that the Apostle Paul was undoubtedly an amazing character. Here is one man who believes in the sovereignty of God, overruling everything that happens to us on the journey of life. He is passionate in his commitment to the providence of God. How do I know? Well, even though he finds himself chained to a Roman soldier, Paul knows that he is exactly where God wants him to be. And you find echoes of that in the opening verses there in the third chapter. 24 hours every day is a long time to put in, when quite frankly, you can't go anywhere and you can't do very much. He's under a kind of first century lockdown. And so I asked myself the pertinent question, how did Paul pass the time? Well, my friends, apart from putting quill to parchment and writing many of his prison epistles, do you know what he did? He spent a lot of time witnessing to those soldiers who were guarding him day and night. After all, as I say with tongue in cheek, he had a captive congregation. And so from Paul's point of view, it was far, far too good a chance for him to miss. But that's not all that he did. When you come down to verses 14 to 19, you will notice that Paul's prison cell actually becomes a prayer cell. And wow, what a prayer it proves to be. He's pretty much saying something like this, that we are to personalize all that we have in Jesus Christ. And so Paul longs for you and for me, that we might be the kind of people that God wants us to be. And so he passionately pours out his heart that we might find our potential realized in God. Did you notice about this prayer? There's a couple of different aspects to it. Because number one, it's an individual kind of a prayer. It's me praying for this to happen to me. and it's you praying for this to happen to you. But secondly, it's also a corporate prayer, because together, you and me, we can pray for this to happen to every one of us as a congregation of God's chosen people in Gorton, in Manchester. And so in the space of a few verses, he talks about the secret of this beautifully idyllic relationship. But having done that, he also provides us with remarkable insight into the resources that are available to us. So the big question this morning is this: how does he go about it? Well, take a look at verse 14 and verse 15. And there you'll find something of his approach. Did you notice Paul's posture as he prayed? How did he do it? Well, we find down there it tells us that he kneels before the Father in heaven. In other words, he bends the knee in the presence of God. And I'm sure some of you have often wondered on occasion, how is the best way for us to pray? Well, my friends, it seems to me that you can read the Bible from cover to cover, Genesis to Revelation. Do you know what you'll discover? Different people do it in different ways, at different times. I mean, it's as simple and it is as confusing as that. Let me give you one or two examples that you'll be able to identify with. Abraham stood before the Lord when he interceded for the city of Sodom in Genesis 18. On the other hand, David sat before the Lord when he prayed about the future of his kingdom in 1 Chronicles 17. And then you've got the classic example. The Lord Jesus himself actually fell on his face when he prayed beneath the ancient olive trees in the Garden of Gethsemane. So there you have it, my friends. One man stands, one man sits, one man is prostrate, and the other one kneels. I say to you this morning, when it comes to prayer, you take your pick. But I also say to you this morning, as I say to myself as well, it doesn't really matter how we do it, so long as we do it. And so far as the apostle himself is concerned, here is a man on bended knee. But that said, my dear friends, the important thing for you and for me is that we bow our hearts and we bend our wills before the Lord. Now, the next question is, to whom is he praying? Well, again, you find the answer down there, don't you? He is addressing the Father. The Father. Now, let me put it like this. That's the usual way to do it, isn't it? In fact, I will go further and say to you this morning, this is the biblical way to do it. We speak to the Father through the Son in the Holy Spirit. And you know, isn't it wonderful to realize that he is our loving Heavenly Father, and that you and I are his redeemed and ransomed children? And even today, because he is our good and our gracious Father, we don't come before him in fear and trembling. No, no. We don't come before him afraid that he will rebuff us or be indifferent to us. Far from it. We can draw near. We can come close. We can approach him with confidence and with boldness. And then did you notice what Paul goes on to say? And this is so relevant for you in this anniversary occasion. He goes on to say this, that you can find us as the people of God in one of two different places. Isn't that a powerful reminder to every one of us today that we are sons and daughters in an international family? You and I are part of a global community of believers. But the truth of the matter is this: some members of the family are no longer with us. They are in heaven, while the rest of us are still down here in this old world. And I'm sure as you check back the records of the last 4.5 decades in the life of your blossoming congregation, that will be ever so true. Some are now with the Lord, having fought a good fight. But others, thankfully, are still with us, watching and listening to the program this morning. Because the fact of the matter is, dear friends, no matter where we are, here or there, we remain an integral part of the family of God. Now, did you notice what Paul goes on to do right there? He gives us a twofold secret for you and I finding fulfillment in the Lord Jesus Christ. Number one, we have access to the Father. By faith, we can touch that higher throne. And guess what? We can reach out to him at any time. And we can come before him from any place. Isn't that a blessed and sweet reality in your life and mine today? But the second thing is this. We are accepted by the Father. In other words, he takes us the way that we are, for he looks in you and me this morning as perfected in the Lord Jesus Christ. We are clothed in his righteousness alone. We can approach him, and we are accepted by him. And then look what he does in verse 16 to verse 19, because here is Paul's request, his prayer. In fact, did you notice there are four parts to it? Now, let's be very clear today, folks. We're not to look at each of these as if they were individual or even isolated petitions. No, no, they're not standalone, but rather each one is linked to the one before it and the one that follows after it. It's like walking up a flight of stairs. It is one at a time, but when you take that one, it automatically leads onto the one coming after it. So what does the Apostle Paul do? He prays that, first of all, the inner man might be strengthened. And then that leads to a deeper experience of Jesus Christ. And that then enables us to grasp the greatness of the love of God. And that finally, number four, results in our being filled with all the fullness of God. Four resources for you as an individual and for you as a congregation on this Sapphire anniversary. Resource number one, we're introduced to that down there in verse 16, where Paul is speaking about the invincible Spirit of God. The invincible Spirit of God. You see, friends, in your church and mine, your life and mine, it all goes back to the work and ministry of the Holy Spirit, doesn't it? And the fact that we know his presence within us, that is a clear indication that we already belong to Jesus Christ, Romans chapter 8. But you know, Paul isn't thinking here primarily about his presence within us, but rather his power upon us. The verse that immediately springs to mind is Acts 1 and verse 8, where we read, "You shall receive power when the Holy Spirit is come upon you." You see, dear friends, without him operating in your life and in mine, we can do absolutely nothing. Did you notice in the gospel narrative that when the Lord Jesus was performing his ministry in this world, how did he do it? He always did it with the anointing of the Spirit upon him. No matter what he did it in the energy of the Spirit of God. In fact, you go further to then read through the Acts of the Apostles, all 28 chapters, and you can see his work amplified in the context of the early church. In fact, if my reckoning is correct, he is spoken of there at least 64 times. And what a book that is. It's a book that charts the early years of the primitive church. The Spirit of God was central to their forward march. He's the reason why the flame spread so rapidly around the then known world. So the question this morning, according to Paul right here, is simply this. How is he given to us? Well, you have the answer there, don't you? According to Paul, it is out of his glorious riches. Isn't that thrilling and yet so very humbling? We receive him, the Spirit of God, by faith at the moment of our conversion. We don't need to work anything up. No, no, the power has to be sent down. And he gives them to us richly because he has lavished his best upon us. And my friend, there's no need for you and for me to walk around in the tattered rags of our own inadequacy, when you and I can live 24/7 sumptuously in the superabundance of God's unspeakable riches. Thank God today, we know something and someone when we have the invincible Spirit of God. And you see, folks, whatever happens to us down here, we can't do without his power in the inward man. Hey, we know from experience, don't we, that the outward man is perishing day after day after a day. Whether we like it or whether we don't, you and I, we're wasting away. But says the writer, 2 Corinthians 4, the inward man is being refreshed, reinvigorated, renewed every single day. And that happens in your life, in your church, when we are a people controlled by the Lord, who is the invincible Spirit. Now, the second resource is found in the opening phrase down there in verse 17, where Paul is talking about the indwelling Son of God. The indwelling Son of God. You see what he says in that sentence? It's Paul's aspiration for them and for you and for me, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. Do you know what that actually means? It means that Christ might settle down and feel at home in your heart and in my life. You see, dear friends, the Lord Jesus is there already in the person of the Holy Spirit. That's why he called them saints in verse 1 of chapter 1. So what's he doing here? Well, he's praying for every one of us that we might have a deeper, deeper experience of Christ in our lives. He just yearns for Jesus to feel at home in your life and mine. Now, we don't have time to look at it this morning, but you find that truth beautifully illustrated in John 14 and in verses 15 to 24. Read it for yourself this afternoon when you've got a spare minute or two. But you know, it's also portrayed powerfully, I think, in the life of Father Abraham. You remember God was going to bless Abraham and Sarah with a son. So what happened? Well, the Lord himself came down and he visited Abraham in his Bedouin tent in the desert. But he didn't come alone, did he? No, no. There were a couple of angels who came along with him. And so they came to the tent and they chatted together for a wee while. They even enjoyed a delicious meal, the one with the other. It was a moment to savor. It was something Abraham would never, ever forget. You see, the Lord and the angels felt at home with Abraham. You know why? Because Abraham was a man of faith and a man of obedience. But look, friends, that's not the end of the story, is it? Certainly not. There was another mission which needed to be attended to with quite some urgency, because they also had to investigate the sins of Sodom. Why? Because God planned to destroy the cities of the plain, because their sin was proving so obnoxious and detestable to him. But there was a big problem. Do you know what the problem was? Lot. Lot was a believer who was living right on the edge of sin city Sodom. And God, in his grace, in his mercy, he wanted to warn him to get out of the city before the judgment would fall. So the question is, who went and told him? Who tipped him off as to what was in the mind of God? Who gave Lot and his family advance warning? Well, I can tell you who it wasn't. It wasn't the Lord. No. He didn't go anywhere near Sodom. Do you know who it was? It was the two angels who passed on the message. The two angels delivered the message. You can read all about it in Genesis 18 and Genesis 19. The question, my friend, is this. Why did the Lord visit Abraham and not visit with Lot? Now, a fairly simple kind of answer is the one that I proffer to you this morning. And it is this. It appears the Lord didn't feel at home in Lot's house the way he felt at home in Abraham's tent. And that's it, beloved friends. Simple as that. When it comes to your life and to mine, to your church and to mine, he wants to make our hearts his home. He wants to commune with us and enjoy fellowship with us as friend to friend. He wants to show his love to us, and he longs to share his life with us. And so Paul is reminding us right here that if you and I want to be the kind of people that God wants us to be, number one, we thank God that we have the invincible Spirit of God. And number two, we thank God because we have the indwelling Son of God. But the third resource is found at the end of verse 17 through to halfway into verse 19. And that's where you and I come face to face with his so great salvation. The torchlight is shining here on the love of God. My friend, this really thrills me today for something you and I can experience moment by moment. In fact, did you notice that Paul used two words here that take us into two different worlds, two different realms? One word is linked with biology, and the other word is related to a building. Let me show you what I mean. The verb rooted takes us into the plant world. You see, the tree must get its roots down deep into the soil if it is to find nourishment and stability. So it is with you and I as believers in the Lord Jesus. Our roots must go down deep into the love of God. The question is, where do we find nourishment for our souls? Where do we find a degree of stability in a topsy-turvy kind of world? Well, my friends, if there is to be power in the Christian life, then there must be a measure of real depth. Now, the second word is the word established or grounded. And that's an architectural term. It actually refers to the foundations on which we are to build. And here's the bottom line, my friends. Not only is that the most important part of any construction, but the reality is, if you don't go down deep, you can't go up high. True? If you don't go down deep, you can't go up high. You see what Paul is saying to us right here? That our foundation is the love of God. And you can't beat that. You can't even improve in that. But you know what you can do? You can build upon it. And when you have such a solid and stable base in your life, you will be able to weather every storm. You'll be able to face all that life will throw at you. Why? Because your life is built on a sure foundation. So this is something we can experience. But then take a look at verse 18. Paul says it's something that can be examined. I mean, if you lift the lid on this wonderful, wonderful verse, do you know what you'll discover? This love is so incredibly special. I mean, it doesn't have three dimensions to it, as usual. It has four dimensions to it. It is wide and long and high and deep. And then did you see what Paul does? He goes on to challenge us to grasp this, to comprehend it, and then to make it our very own. It's as though Paul is saying to you and to me today, look, folks, here is the love of God. It is so vast. It is limitless. It just can't be contained. It can't even be measured. But you can lay hold of it. And so the question this morning is this: how long is the love of God? How long is God's love? Well, that's a $6 million question, isn't it? Let me answer it by another question. When did he start loving us? And when will he stop loving us? You see, my friend, the fact of the matter is this, that his love, it stretches from eternity to eternity. You remember he said to his servant Jeremiah, on one of those occasions, when he was having the blues, that he was loved with an everlasting love. Beloved friends, in Gorton today, he loved us before the world began. He loves us right now at this moment in time. And you know, he will still be loving us when time is no more. Who can possibly measure that? As the wee song says, his love is so long, you never come to the end of it. But how wide is the love of God? Well, there's a marvelous breadth to it, isn't there? Because in this particular context, it not only embraced the Jewish people, but the rest of us who were Gentiles as well. And what you have right here is a wide open invitation to all men everywhere to come to faith in Jesus Christ. You, dear friends, know as well as I do, the glorious gospel message is to the whosoever will. It's so wide, there is room for you, and there's room for me as well. It embraces all sinners who take advantage of God's offer of mercy, because his love is so wide, you can never get around it. How deep is the love of God? Well, it was love which brought him down from the highest heights of heaven. It was love which moved him to sit with sinners when others ran a mile in the opposite direction. It was love which enabled him to effectively minister to those who had sunk to the very depths of sin. My dear friend, the apostle knew more about that than many of us, because he saw himself as the chief of sinners. And yet the love of Jesus, it met him where he was. I thank God today, as I'm sure you do as well, for the deep, deep love of Jesus. Speaking personally, even though I had wandered far away from him, his arm reached out and it brought me back. Even though I'd fallen low in the gutter and the grime of sin, his love reached down and it picked me up. Oh, my dear friend, in the story of your life, his love is so deep, you can never get to the bottom of it. And the last one begs the question, doesn't it? How high is his love? Well, you read Ephesians 1 and think of the heights to which he has already lifted us. We are the adopted sons and daughters of the Most High God. We are seated today in heavenly places. We know we're going to enter into our inheritance, but says the beloved Apostle John, what we will be has not yet been made known. Ah, my friends, you and I are going to be lifted to heights of glory, which the Bible hasn't even begun to describe. It blows the mind. It just seems to me that his love is so high, you will never be able to get over it. You know, the old gospel hymn, it puts it like this, and I'm sure many of you will recognize these words. Could we withink the ocean fill, where the skies a parchment made, where every stalk on earth a quill, and every man a scribe by trade, to write the love of God above would drain the ocean dry, nor could the scroll contain the whole, though stretched from sky to sky. We can experience it. We can even examine it. But here's where the rubber hits the road at the beginning of verse 19. We're called upon to exhibit it. You see what Paul says right there? I want you to know it. And then in the very next breath, he says, it surpasses knowledge. I want you to know it, even though it surpasses knowledge. It's what they call a paradox. I mean, what can we say about such love today? Calvary love, a love that will not let us go. My dear friends, there are dimensions to it, but we can never measure it. You and I are so rich in him, but the riches of his love can never be estimated or even calculated. I think the fairly modern song puts it like this, sums it up best. Such love springs from eternity. Such love streaming through history. Such love, fountain of life to me. O Jesus, such love. The final resource is found at the end of verse 19, where Paul would direct our hearts to the sufficiency we have in God. The sufficiency we have in God. You see what Paul's longing is there? That you and I might be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. My friend, put simply, this is what God wants you and I to experience individually and congregationally. Something of his fullness. Let me put it like this. The means of our fullness is the Holy Spirit, and the measure of our fullness is God himself. You know, sometimes you and me, human nature being what it is, we tend to look at other people, don't we? For better, for worse. We often compare ourselves with other people, don't we? I'm sure if I was to ask you one by one, every one of us would tick that box, wouldn't we? Now look, let's be honest today. It depends who you compare yourself with as to how good you feel at the end of it, doesn't it? But you see, when we do that, what happens? We give ourselves a totally false picture. It can give to me and to you a misguided feeling of security. We're only fooling ourselves as to where we are at spiritually. Other people are not the yardstick. You see what Paul says here? He says that Christ is the measure. He is the standard. He is the rule. Do you know what that means? Back to Ephesians 2. It means that you and I can boast about nothing. So far as we are concerned, it's the zero option. You know why? Because when we have reached his fullness, then we have reached the limit. It's the top of the ladder. And the next stop is heaven, its glory. And my dear friends, here we are in 2021. Our position right now is that you and I are complete in Christ. Thank God we are. But in the rough and tumble of today's world, we enjoy only the grace that we apprehend by faith. The resources are there, and I've spelt them out for you this morning. But if you and I want to find our potential realized in God, you know what we need to do? Prayerfully tap into every one of those four resources. That's what Paul highlights for us in the benediction in verses 20 and 21. To him who was able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine. And my dear friends, on this very special occasion, I sincerely trust that Paul's prayer will be answered in your life today, and that in your future, as an individual and as a church family, that you might find in the Lord Jesus Christ, one who is truly your everything and your all. And isn't that why God's grace is so utterly amazing? Amen. Amen.
Sam, thank you for your words to us today from the Lord. Let's take a moment of quiet and prayer to respond to what the Lord has said to us. Maybe there's just something that Sam said that's lodged in your mind that you want to lodge in your heart today. Let's pray that the Lord will speak to us as he has spoken through Sam into our hearts today. Father God, in response to your word in the scriptures and all that Sam has said to us today, we pray that you may help us to know the love that is in Christ, that we may be able to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ and be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Father, may we not go from here just having shrugged off all that we have heard, but that something of what we have heard may stay with us and go deep into our heart and lives to change us and transform us, to bless us and encourage us, that through your word you may change us and make us more like Jesus. So, Lord, we pray for each other, that your blessing may be upon each one of us. We pray for our church at Trinity, celebrating our anniversary today, particularly for those who have not been joining us Sunday by Sunday because they're not able to, because of lack of technology or because they have other things that have kept them away. They found this whole experience difficult. And some maybe who have, we don't know, some maybe who have drifted away from you. We pray, Lord, that you may call all who find, who know Trinity as their church, to that measure of the fullness of Christ and to that knowledge of Jesus Christ as their Lord and Saviour. That you may establish us again as your church, as your people, as those who are reflecting the love of Christ to one another and to the world around us. Help us to take these words of scripture and these words that we have heard today into not just our own private life, but into the life that we share with others and the way we reflect Jesus into the world around. And Lord, into this time of prayer also, we pray for those who we know who need a particular touch of your healing, of your blessing and encouragement, of strength from the Lord today. Without mentioning names in this very public forum, we lay these people before you, people known to us, and perhaps even those whose needs are not known to us, but known to you, Lord God. Your blessing and healing and strength. Those in our families, those in our circles of friends, those in our church and other churches, those who do not know you yet as Lord, who we seek to reach for Christ. And we pray for our city, our nation, and our world in this time of need. Lord, may we soon be rid of this virus, which is causing so much trouble in our nation and in many other nations in the world. We pray for our nation, Lord. We pray this week for the nation of the United States, particularly as they welcome a new president this week. And we pray for your blessing on that new president, Joe Biden, and all who will be taking office. And we pray for your peace and for your justice to be known in the nations of the world. Lord, hear our hearts this day and hear our prayers in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Saviour. Amen. So So we thank Sam for being with us today and bringing God's word to us. And we're going to finish our service today with a song. After this, those who can stay on our Zoom meeting will be going into breakout groups for prayer. But those who can't stay will be leaving, and those on Facebook will be finishing our meeting at the end of this song. We're going to sing together a modern hymn that is loved by many about the love that is in the Lord Jesus, that has those four dimensions that Sam has talked about. Its breadth, its love, how wide and long, how deep and high is this love that is in Christ alone. Let's sing that hymn together now.
My all in all, here in the love of Christ.
Here in the power of Christ I stand. He is the solid rock on which we stand, he and no other. Thank you for being with us today. Thank you to all those who have joined us. Thank you to Sam, our guest preacher today. We've had appreciative words on Facebook for what Sam has shared with us from Godwin and Afia and Theophilia and Nana and Rita and Susan and, oh, Godwin again. Thank you to all those who have been with us on Facebook Live. We're going to say goodbye to you now and God bless you. Let's pray as we bring this part of our gathering together to an end. Father God, we bless you for your goodness to us on this anniversary day. We bless you for your goodness through the years. And we thank you for the love of Christ in all its dimensions that holds us and gives us strength. And now may the grace of Christ be with us as we go into this week. Be with us, Lord. Give us your strength. And may that love that never ends envelop us and be with us in all our days. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So we're going to say goodbye to all those on Facebook and who are watching this on YouTube. Thank you for being with us.